A very warm welcome to everybody this afternoon. We are glad that you are on the call and have been able to join us for this prayer time. We trust that we're going to have a great time together, talking to the Lord about concerns that we have. My name is Ngwiza Mkandla. I'm president of AFReG, the AFReG Global Board. I'll be your moderator for this prayer connection time together. I'll be assisted by our sister, Dr. Obwaka from Kenya. We have every reason to give thanks to the Lord and to praise our great God as we gather together around the throne of God from across the nations of Africa, the diaspora, and the world. Particularly for the United States, this is, Thanksgiving Day. And as we reflect upon his loving kindness and mercies that are renewed to us every single morning and his unwavering faithfulness, we cannot adequately express in words how thankful we are. Even in places and in times when we've gone or are going through difficult, situations, his promises stand true. He will never leave us nor forsake us. Our purpose as the African Forum on Religion and Government is to build a movement of African leaders of integrity who are committed to transforming Africa into a premier continent based on God-centered values. We are excited for these monthly prayer connection times because we know that prayer changes things. We believe together God will intervene in the affairs of our beloved continent and change the hearts of our leaders, our communities, families, and so on as we pray. Let his kingdom come and his will be done. We will petition him on behalf of every country on the continent. I'd like to let you know that AFReG posts two devotionals a month on the second and last Thursday of every month. In this season, we're focusing on the transformation, how transformation actually happens, changing against the tide. You may view these devotionals on our website. In our prayer connection time today, as we give thanks, we'll be focusing on, bringing some highlights from some troubled spots around Africa. We're going to be looking at Ethiopia. We're going to look at Mali. We're going to look at Mozambique, at Sudan, and as well as South, Sudan. So let us begin with a word of prayer, and then I'll hand over to Dr. Emily to take us through the first segment of our time together. Let's bow your heads with me as we pray. Father, thank you for everyone that's on the call today, and thank you again for the opportunity to come into your presence on behalf of Africa. Lord, we thank you that you love this continent. And we thank you that you love its peoples and that you've got an agenda for this continent. We ask, Lord, that you'll help us this afternoon to connect with your heart for the continent and to feel what you feel for her. And Lord, through the Holy Spirit, would you guide our prayers? For the glory of your name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Dr. Emily, take us from here.
Thank you, Bishop Ngwiza. Good afternoon, everyone, from where I am, and good morning, good evening. What a joy it is to come to a place where we are bringing thanks to this great God who has invited us to come boldly into his presence at any time of day or night and bring a song of thanksgiving. And that's our focus this afternoon. And I want us to lead to connect in prayer over the word of God as we begin our time together. This will provide a context for our being able to look at the different countries we've had mentioned. There may be troubled spots, but in whatever difficulty we are in, we can thank God. So I'll be sharing the screen now and just helping us to go through Psalm 138. It is the Psalm of David. It is a Psalm of David. And it helps us just connect around things that we are thankful for this afternoon. We will have a time to connect, so I'll be asking us to unmute ourselves and pray aloud in whatever language that easiest comes to you as we begin together. So as we look at Psalm 138, the first portion of it, in fact, let me read it out so that we are together on this. I thank you, Lord, and with all the passion of my heart, I worship you in the presence of angels. Some versions say in the presence of gods. Heaven's mighty ones will hear my voice as I sing my loving praise to you. I bow down before your divine presence and bring my deepest worship as I experience your tender love and your living truth. For your word and the fame of your name have been magnified above all else. At the very moment I called out to you, you answered me. You strengthened me deep within my soul. And you strengthened me deep within my soul and breathed fresh courage into me. One day, all the kings of the earth will rise to give you thanks when they hear the living words that I have heard you speak. They too will sing of your wonderful ways, for your ineffable glory is great. For though you are lofty and exalted, you stoop to embrace the lowly. Yet you keep your distance from those filled with pride. By your mighty power, I can walk through any devastation, and you will keep me alive, reviving me. Your power set me free from the hatred of my enemies. You keep every promise you've ever made to me. Since your love for me is constant and endless, I ask you, Lord, to finish every good thing that you've begun in me. Amen. So the first portion of that is the first two verses invite us to worship and adore God. And as we focus on this, I want to draw our attention to the way we thank God with all the passion of our hearts, how we sing our loving praise to him, how we bring our deepest worship to him. And I want us to unmute our mics. Microphones and just engage through the atmosphere of our communion.
Thank you,
Lord. Speak out in worship, speak out in tongues, speak out in adoration of this, thank our you, great Jesus. God who has invited us to this you. Place of thanksgiving and oh, praise. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Brothers and sisters, Amen. Brothers and sisters, we come to verse 3, and verse 3 talks about thanking God for answered prayer. As you look back on this year, as you look back at this trying and difficult period we've all been through, as you look at how, you know, the difficult situations God may have brought you through, aren't you thankful that God has answered prayer? At this very moment, I called out to you. You answered me. And not only answered me, you were the answer to my cry, because you strengthened me deep within my soul and breathed fresh courage into me. Brothers and sisters, I want us to continue to thank God for answered prayer. Speak to God and say, thank you for this answered prayer. Thank you for this particular situation you came into for me. In We want to look at the next three verses, brothers and sisters. And we see here that the proclamation, the prophetic proclamation, is that all kings of all the earth will give thanks to you when they hear the words that you have spoken, the words, the gospel that brings people into the light of the kingdom of God. When they too will sing your wonderful ways, for your indescribable glory is great. And how will it happen? This lofty God who reaches down even through his son Jesus and embraces us, even in as we repent, we respond to him, we come to him. The Bible says the glory of God will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. Let us declare forth this prophetic proclamation, even over nations that look very far from where God probably wants them to be. Let us proclaim the covering of the glory of God on all the earth, in all the nations, wherever we are. Let us proclaim.
Proclaim your name. Thank
you, Lord. We proclaim that indeed you will reach every part of our earth in Jesus' name. Glory be to thee, O God. Amen and amen. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse 6 speaks about pride that would distance us from being, from coming into God's presence. What is it that would keep us from experiencing God? In this verse, we are told that God distancing himself from the proud. What is it in our parts of the world that would distance us from this great God? What is it that keeps us from enjoying the fellowship with the Lord? Brothers and sisters, I invite us to bring repentance on behalf of ourselves, our families, our communities, our nations, that indeed God, who is merciful, will forgive, will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Why don't you unmute and cry out to God on behalf of our nation, Jesus? My Father, have mercy on us. Mercy on us, O God, where we have fallen short of your glory. We have walked in rebellion, O God, where we have been, O God, pleading, O God, where we have need your mercy today, O God. Need your mercy, O God. Need your mercy, O God. Need your mercy and grace, O God. Forgive us, Lord. Since you are unrighteous, Thank you, Lord. Thank you for forgiving our sins. Thank you for a new day. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Our final slide now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. In this last slide, which is the last two verses of Psalms 138, we declare, by your mighty power, we as the continent of Africa walk through any devastation. We are kept alive. Hallelujah. You revive us. Hallelujah. Your power sets us free from the hatred of our enemies in the name of Jesus Christ. You keep every promise you have made to us, every promise. Since your love for us is constant and endless, we ask you, Lord, to finish every good thing that you began in us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray and believe. Amen. 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 Glory to God.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, our God is faithful, and we know our prayer is heard before him. And indeed, we have received that which we have made mention to him of. Hallelujah. This afternoon, we have focus countries, and we're going to be looking at Ethiopia as our first nation. We want to introduce our person representing Ethiopia, Dr. Yared Makenon. Dr. Makenon is a resident in Nairobi at this moment, because he heads the operations, the program operations with Life in Abundance International. Dr. Yared is a medical doctor with training and work over 20 years, and he is very experienced in public health, in development, and in leadership. He works to empower churches in transformational development, and he has worked not only in the countries in Africa, but also in the Caribbean and countries beyond. So we want to welcome him just to share on Ethiopia and give us a highlight on what we need to be praying for. And then he will make a declaration at the end concerning the nation of Ethiopia. Most welcome, Dr. Yared. Most welcome. You may need to unmute. Thank you.
Sorry, I was on mute. Thank you for inviting me. And then I've already sensed the presence of the Lord. And I really thank you, because people who have the heart for others, what God needs today is people with the heart. Most of the time, head is available. Information, mind, technology, expertise, many things are available. But where is the heart for others? And I thank you for your heart, coming together and interceding for others, for the poor, for the vulnerable, for injustice, for oppressed, for discouraged, for depressed. And that is really inspired me already. And I thank you. I just want to appreciate you. And I know God is pleased. I know God is pleased with this. So having said that, I just want to really share about Ethiopia, maybe. Pray for Ethiopia, and as I said, stand before God in the gap on behalf of the land, on behalf of the people. Ezekiel chapter 22:13, you know how God was looking for a person to stand on the gap, but he found none. But I'm so happy and I'm encouraged to see you standing on this gap, and I'm as well happy to be with you to share my burden and my friend's burden and others as well, and including you as an African brothers and as the body of Christ. And so all of us, if the body of Christ, wherever, universally, if one is touched, and I know you feel the pain and the agony. So that's what's happening right now. So to pray for Ethiopia, so here we are. How is Ethiopia today? Ethiopia is sick today. Ethiopia is sick. And the sickness is because of the conflict. And the conflict touches every area of human life. It touches the health, economy, social, and education, agriculture sector. Everything is touched by this conflict. As an individual, your emotion, your psychology, your health, everything. Even if you are not there in the midst of the war, but wherever you are, you feel that. So the country has been in conflict for the last 1 year because of the war inflicted by the TPLF in the northern part of Ethiopia. I don't want to go to that details. That's not our aim here. But the process, what happened. I want you to really see with me and to stand on the gap with me. Currently, 70 million people have been seriously affected, and out of which 4.3 million internally displaced. 3.4 million need immediate relief intervention. And 7.2 million are returnees who are settled in temporary refugee centers. As you see, 17 million. And I want you to look those faces and look at them beyond their shoe. And then look at them displaced from their home. They are everywhere scattered. And then they may not have even food and clothes and, you know, and their emotional and psychological pain and loneliness and uncertainty and insecurity of the future. So that's really painful for those people right there. That's my burden, that's my worry. And then if you really cut in the region, you see the war advances to Afar, Amhara, and then, as you know, Tigray is the main region where it started. So in Afar alone, 618,000 people were affected, of which 350 of them are internally displaced. In Amhara region, 5 million, as you see, 34,000 people, and 2.1 million people are internally displaced. Tigray region, around 5 million and 194,000 people are affected, of which 1 million and 800, almost close to 2 million, internally displaced. Now you can see the pain. And then just simply I focused on the people, and but the infrastructure destroyed in this conflict, the school in Amhara, in Afar, including Tigray, in the process, you can see the school, the infrastructure destroyed by this one, and the hospital, you can imagine. And all this destruction affected not only right now the future of Ethiopia, the future of Ethiopia. So the rehabilitation and the restoration of Ethiopia takes time, and we need to really pray, and we need to really intercede and stand on these gaps without any bias and any other interest. So I thank you for that, just to really give you the picture. And I just want to invite you to stand on the gaps and the prayer request. I want you to pray for the hands of the Lord to intervene and make a peaceful closure to this devastating conflict. If you ask me, what are you looking for? I'm looking for his hand, mighty hand. The solution is from heaven. The solution is from Christ. That's what we are asking, we are interceding, we are praying. So that peaceful closure is coming from heaven, and that is miraculous intervention. That hand is possible because, you know one thing? Jesus told us in Matthew chapter 16, verse 19, that you see, this is as well, the church said, I will establish my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. And then he continued saying that I've given you the keys of the kingdom. So that keys have, you know, has a power to lock and unlock, and to lock and to bring, to unlock peace and to, you know, joy and righteousness, that kingdom blessing, and to lock the gates of hell. So that no conflict, no war, no pain, no agony, no distress. So that hands has that power to stop. So you and me can understand these kinds of intervention, of the kingdom intervention. So let's pray that the hands of the Lord to come, and then pray that the Holy Spirit will touch the heart of all the people to repent and unite as one nation. Unless the Holy Spirit touch, it is not that easy for Peace and Reconciliation Forum or any other strategies we think will be a reality. So the Holy Spirit, let's invite that. The third point, pray for the people who are directly affected by the war in meeting their immediate basic need like food, clothing, and shelter, including emotional and psychological stability. Pray for the political leaders at all levels to make peace as their top priority. Pray for Ethiopian churches to aggressively engage in peace and reconciliation ministry through intercessory prayer and organizing peace and reconciliation forums. And pray for all international and national media to be more responsible in broadcasting the current realities in the country. And then again, pray for the emotional and psychological restoration of many raped women due to this war. Pray for children dropped out of school, neglected and abused in the course of the war. Pray for government leaders to have godly wisdom to lead the people in this crisis season without further damage to the social, economical, health, and education sectors of the country. And pray for the international communities to stand on the gaps without any political bias and other national interests. And pray for the neighboring countries and the whole regions to have sustainable peace and stability. Finally, let's pray for all Ethiopian believers in Christ to be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power, and put on the full armor of God that we can stand against the devil's camp in Ethiopia. I believe the root cause for all this war and conflict that you see is demonic for me. If you discern it spiritually in the Horn region, the root cause is a spiritual warfare. A spirit out there to make a bloodshed. He's out there in a sea right now. The temporary crisis. People may have shortage of food and shelter and so on. But how about the eternal days? How about the eternal days? People without knowing Christ going straight to hell. Let's pray for that as well. So let's break that chain. Let's break that demonic scheme. So I invite you to open and then really pray on this just for a while. I will just and then I'll continue to the next. And let's join, because prayer shapes history. Let's open our mouth and let's confess it. Let's pray, let's intercede. And let's really on these items, as God really directs you and inspires you. And maybe you may focus on one or two or three points. Maybe the Holy Spirit touches you. One of you may be touched by one item or two items, all what I have already shared. So you just pray as Holy Spirit guides you. Just focus on one or two or three as God guides you right now. I believe, my brothers and sisters, I believe God will answer our prayer.
Lord, we
because you don't have any other motive.
Wow. Jesus right now. And
hallelujah, Jesus.
Oh, we come before you.
L'évangile, Seigneur, que ta puissance soit déployée
Amen.
I want you to join me again on prophetic prayer and thanksgiving. It's like a prophetic proclamation. As I was praying, God really gave me three things. I just put it as a three R's. The first thing is God wants us to have a revelation of God's ultimate plan. What is it God is doing now in Ethiopia? So what is it exactly? So I was just reading, and God, I believe the Holy Spirit led me to Ezekiel chapter 37, 4-5. And then it says, he asked me, son of man, can this bone live? I said, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. And then prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath into you and you will come to life. So the first thing is the revelation. God needs revelation of God's ultimate plan. That is only possible through the Holy Spirit. You know, like anyone of all of us, when you look at the situation, it's frustrating, it's discouraging, it's depressing. In fact, it is dry. And in fact, when beyond dry, it's dead. Dry bones indicate frustration, hopelessness. So that's what it is, the situation right now. But God is really putting this in my heart. Ethiopia as a kingdom platform to demonstrate his enduring love, grace, power, and wisdom to the whole world. I am praying, and God is really putting and thanking him that he's going to turn this situation where God will be seen, where Jesus will be seen, and his enduring love, grace, and power, and wisdom will be seen to the whole world. That's what is going to happen. I want you to join me. This is a prophetic proclamation and a prophetic prayer. And the second is a reconciliation among the people. And then I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you'll come to life. Then you'll know that I am the Lord. I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked and tendons and flesh appeared on them and skin covered them. As you look at them, you see things are coming together. People are closing to one another. And then you see this is a reconstruction. This is reconciliation. This is the people will be reconciled, united, and reconstructed as a nation with a strong economy and social bond. This is a prophetic insight and proclamation again. I want you to join me. And the third one is raising the nation as a vast army, revived and strong nation, witnessing the resurrection power of Christ. That is the final one. Prophesy to the breeze, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the Sovereign Lord says, come, breathe from the four winds, and breathe into this land that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breathed into them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. So these are the three things that I want you to really proclaim, pray, and confess over the nation. Thank you. God bless you.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
We move to the next.
Amen.
Bishop Ngwiza.
All right. Thank you so much, Brother Yared. If you could stop screen share and we will move on to the next nation. We're going to look at Mali, just so that we catch up on our time. We are privileged this afternoon to have Pastor Samuel Maribabago from Mali, who's going to share with us what is happening in Mali and what we should be praying for. Brother Samuel, I'll ask you to be very brief so that we then you share just the prayer points and then we will go straight into prayer. He's going to speak in French, and so I'm going to ask all the English speakers if you'll go to your interpretation icon at the bottom there. And then, you know, switch over to select English so that you can hear the translation. So, Brother Samuel, please, would you go ahead and share with us what the prayer points are? And then immediately after you've shared, we'll go into prayer.
Okay. Okay, bonjour à tous. Je suis dans la joie ce jour d'être avec vous sur ce plateforme. Et je bénis le Seigneur pour vraiment cette initiative. Et c'est une très grande joie pour moi de savoir, comme mon prédécesseur a dit, qu'il y a des hommes, vraiment des institutions ou encore des groupes qui sont là, qui intercèdent pour les nations, qui intercèdent pour les pays, pour vraiment aider ces nations et ces pays-là à retrouver leur chemin et que aussi la gloire de Dieu puisse se manifester dans cette nation. Vraiment, je voudrais vous dire merci à vous tous et merci pour le privilège que vous m'avez donné aujourd'hui de pouvoir participer à cette réunion de prière et parler de notre nation du Mali. Donc, en parlant du Mali, effectivement, bon, je me présente. Comme le chef l'a dit, je suis le pasteur Samuel Kodjo. Donc, je suis à la mission d'évangélisation et d'implantation des églises MEIE. Donc, notre pasteur principal est le docteur Apôtre Djenyon Marc Koulibaly. Donc, nous sommes plus dans l'évangélisation et l'implantation des églises. Donc, moi, je suis un pasteur d'une église locale, voilà, affilié au centre Eurobot de Konatebou. Donc, par rapport à la nation malienne, les points quand même qui me viennent beaucoup plus à l'esprit, c'est surtout l'église elle-même. De prier pour l'Église elle-même, de prier pour les leaders, les premiers responsables. Nous savons que réellement, il y a de la guerre voilà, au nord, ça ne va pas et tout. Mais moi, je pense beaucoup plus, parce que comme il a été dit dans la parole de Dieu, mon peuple sur qui, dans Deux Chroniques, mon peuple sur qui est invoqué mon nom, s'il s'humilie, cherche ma face, je guérirai leur nation. Donc, mais si le peuple de Dieu, les leaders, les responsables eux-mêmes n'arrivent pas à s'entendre, à s'unir et réellement à invoquer le Seigneur, ce serait très difficile. Donc, moi, le premier souci que vraiment je voudrais partager et ce pourquoi je voudrais qu'on prie, c'est les premiers responsables de l'Église malienne, les responsables des dénominations. Car si tu regardes beaucoup de plus près, tu verras que beaucoup sont là en train de défendre leur dénomination. Au lieu de chercher l'avancement du royaume, l'intérêt du royaume, la propagation de l'évangile et aussi le salut des âmes, mais beaucoup sont là dans la recherche d'intérêts personnels et de tout ce qu'eux-mêmes ils peuvent avoir. Donc, nous voyons dans les groupements d'églises et responsabilités, nous voyons qu'il n'y a pas d'entente. Il n'y a pas d'entente. S'il y a des projets, il y a des projets que l'Église doit faire ensemble, c'est-à-dire le corps de Christ, les différentes missions, s'assembler et faire des programmes, c'est difficile. Et moi, je me dis, si le peuple ne s'unit pas, Dieu ne pourra pas déverser sa bénédiction et certainement le mal va prospérer. Donc, le premier point vraiment qui me tient à cœur, c'est de prier pour les responsables, que le Saint-Esprit puisse les toucher. Que réellement, ils puissent voir l'intérêt du royaume d'abord, qu'ils puissent s'oublier eux-mêmes, oublier leur dénomination, mais voir d'abord l'intérêt du royaume. Et après cela, nous allons aussi prier pour la nation. Nous savons que nous sommes à une période de transition et c'est vraiment chamboulant, chaud dans la nation. Même depuis les semaines passées, il y avait des grèves. Les banquiers étaient en grève. Il y a beaucoup de couches qui veulent aller en grève. Or, nous savons que nous sommes en période de transition. Des bases doivent être fondées. La transition doit préparer une fondation, doit mettre en place un arsenal, bien sûr, avant de passer le pouvoir. Donc, j'aimerais qu'on prie aussi pour une bonne transition, que vraiment la transition puisse être réussie. Et en troisième point, priez aussi pour la population malienne. Vous voyez, quand vous essayez de voir un peu, il y a, le Mali, c'est comme un cas exceptionnel. Tu vois, il y a beaucoup de choses qui se passent au Mali qu'on ne voit pas dans les autres pays. Par exemple, frapper le président de la République ou encore des coups d'État dans coups d'État. Il y a beaucoup de choses qui sont souvent, quand je regarde et constate, je me dis que c'est souvent unique au Mali. Je voudrais qu'on prie pour la population malienne, que les cœurs soient touchés, que les cœurs puissent s'humilier réellement. Que tout raisonnement qui s'élève contre la connaissance du Seigneur soit brisé et ôté dans les cœurs, afin que cette population soit gagnée à Christ, afin que cette population puisse connaître le Seigneur et que l'Évangile puisse vraiment prospérer dans cette nation du Mali. Et en quatrième point aussi, prier pour les chrétiens, pour les enfants de Dieu, afin que nous ne soyons pas chrétiens de nom, afin que nous ne soyons pas des enfants de Dieu de nom, mais que ce soit réel, que ce soit accompagné par la puissance, que ce soit accompagné par une démonstration d'autorité du Saint-Esprit de Dieu, que dans l'Église, les enfants de Dieu, les chrétiens, puissent prendre au sérieux leur vie spirituelle, qu'ils puissent communier avec le Seigneur, prier réellement et avoir une communion réelle, franche avec le Saint-Esprit, afin que nos vies puissent s'améliorer, nous puissions montrer réellement l'image de Christ et que le Mali tout entier puisse voir la révélation des fils de Dieu dans cette nation du Mali. Donc, voici là un peu quelques points quand même qui nous tiennent vraiment à cœur, pour que nous puissions intercéder pour notre nation du Mali, afin que la gloire de Dieu soit manifeste.
All right.
Premièrement,
thank you so much, Brother Samuel. Let's do this, brothers and sisters, so that we conserve our time. Let's go to the Lord together. We'll open the floodgates. We all pray. When you hear me say, in Jesus' name, that is a sign that we stop at that point in time. All right?
Let's all go. Right. When
you hear in Jesus' name, you stop. Let's pray.
Okay. Our Lord, we just thank God for many of what you are doing in the country
as a
We're going to move to Mozambique while we are in that part of the country. We're going to move down to Mozambique, where again we are very privileged this afternoon to have Pastor Francisca, who's going to share with us the prayer needs for Mozambique. He is a pastor in Mozambique, and we've asked him to just briefly give us give us three prayer points, and then we will do the same thing. We will pray for them, all in one go. Oh, so over to you, Pastor Francisca.
Yes. As you heard, my name is Francisco Nyamauta. I'm a pastor in the central of Mozambique. I hope everyone is listening to me, hearing. Can
yes,
you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes.
Yes.
I'm going to share three points. One is about cyclones that is hitting Mozambique and the political conflicts that are in Mozambique and the COVID-19. So about the cyclones, we've had a series of cyclones. One was the heaviest, which broke in the central part of Mozambique, namely the city of Beira. and many others came in, and we are expecting more. So that's one of the prayer points, the first one, that we should pray against that natural disaster. And the second one, I'll talk about the COVID-19, which is a general or the worldwide problem or common problem, of which many of us are aware of the disaster that it brought in or the effects that it has brought. But especially here in Mozambique, many people died, of course. And I don't want to mention about the exaggerations of numbers and so on, as we are all aware of it. I'm sure it happens or it's happening in many, many other countries. So the COVID-19 has really brought a lot of deaths, a lot of the effects of the economy. A lot of people lost their jobs, and some are homeless, some are orphans as a result of the heat of this problem. So the third one would be the political conflict. So as you know, Mozambique has passed through a series of conflicts, you know, and now we are in this political conflict, which mainly now is in Cabo Delgado, where it's about the mineral resources that the province has. So there is an invasion of a group of the terrorists that are killing people there, brutally killing people there. And the government, of course, is doing its best to minimize the problem or to cancel that problem. And now it's really much better, because there has been an intervention of troops from abroad or from outside the country, which came and reinforced the defense there, the attacks and so on. So now there's a lot of peace around the province. And also we have struggles, political struggles within the central part, which is also diminishing. So we thank God for that. So those would be my three prayer points. The biggest one is the political situation in Mozambique. And I would add maybe another one, like we should please pray for our government. I'm sure you know of the biggest loan that we had, and it has really brought not a very good name for Mozambique. And that is being resolved and is being solved within the government, within Mozambique. So those are the three main points that I would ask you to please pray for Mozambique, and of course to pray also for the church in Mozambique, because of the effects of the COVID-19. Many churches, I'm sure in other countries also, many believers have grown cold, and the fire is almost like not there. So we really need to pray for the church in Mozambique to take its stand and to rise up again, and to really admit that the time is almost over, Jesus is coming. So we should please rise up as Christians in Mozambique.
Thank you, Pastor Francisco. Let's go to the Lord, brothers and sisters. Let's lift our voices and call to the Lord on behalf of the nation on those three points. Father, we
Thank you, Radiant.
Thank you that Mali is here. You are
I'm going to hand over to Emily. She's going to take us back to the north, where we are going to be praying for the Sudan's, South Sudan and Sudan itself. Dr. Emily.
Thank you, Bishop. This afternoon, we are privileged to have Eric Morilla. Eric is the CEO of Blue Wings, which is an air operator and plies the Nairobi, South Sudan route and Sudan route. And he's going to share something about what's happening on the ground, both in Sudan and South Sudan, and kindly bring the prayer needs so that we can petition God on behalf of these two nations. We have run short of time, so just asking you to focus on, you know, three areas in each country, and then invite us to pray. Karibu sana, Eric Morilla.
Thank you, Dr. Emily. Just as a point of clarification, LIA Blue Wings is serving the humanitarian and aid organizations, as well as the general public who are in very dire need to get from the capital to their villages, which are affected by floods. And we additionally do medical evacuation flights from Juba, South Sudan. Thank you for the opportunity. It's very humbling to be here for such a time as this, because we are mandated with governmental authority to shake things up wherever it is that we go. And the Lord says in the book of, the Bible says in the book of Psalms, chapter 2, verse 8, that ask of me and I will give you nations as an inheritance for you. It is up to us to look at the spiritual atmosphere and cry and call unto the Lord with the keys of the kingdom, like Dr. Yared said, which the Lord also put in my heart, that we can, whatever we refuse, we can be refused, whatever we allow can be permitted. And this is our mandate. So starting with South Sudan, there's endemic corruption. I'll deal with the issue of governance or lack thereof. There's endemic corruption from the top, which is taking the country backwards. You literally would have people come up into the office and claim, ask for money or ask for bribes. And this happens on a day-to-day basis. It has become the way of life, and it's not progressive, it's not helpful for the South Sudan in the direction that it needs to go. There's a lot of civil or the governance issues, civil intolerance and repression, where the defenders of human rights and journalists who expose the truth of what's going on are targets for oppression by the government. They're frequently arrested, they're subdued. The civil servants who would want to have peaceful protests for their concerns to be allayed to the government concerning pay, concerning working conditions. It's not even safe to do that. It's not safe to be vocal about your rights or the denial of your rights. That's on governance. The second thing is a lot of disunity at every level of society. And this is along tribal lines. So there are official functions that will not take place simply because even in an office, it is about one tribe or another. So you can imagine what that does at the level of government and provision of services. Services are just blocked because of a tribal matter. I'm right in the middle of one of them where we had an opportunity to distribute food rations to the United Nations mission in South Sudan. And we literally have had a cancellation. The food has got spoiled. Two trucks have been sent back on two subsequent days, and there's no real or good reason why this cannot be permitted, despite the fact that an official sanction has come from the minister's office. So this is the language here, and is something that we spiritually need to posture ourselves to fight back so that there can be justice, there can be normalcy, and all for the glory of God. So in that aspect of disunity, there's a lot of civil strife and insecurity in the other states, not so much in Juba, but in several other places which are also affected by floods, and a lot of poverty, lack of medicines, lack of basic necessities. There are some that still have camps being run by humanitarian organizations. Some are internally displaced people who need to be relocated. But in the middle of this, what you do not know from outside of South Sudan is that there are occasional battles and fights and wars, mini wars in those states, where it is one faction trying to attempting an upheaval against a different faction, both at army level, SPLM, SPLA, other people who feel that they need to voice the concerns of the civic society. So there's a lot of strife, insecurity, consequential poverty, also as a result of the floods. But at the end of the day, when the governance is not working okay, there's a lot of disunity, services don't reach the people. The security organs are not able to get to where they need to get to be able to serve the multitudes. Medicines, foods, basic necessities are not able to get into the interior. And at the core of the issue is just evil, if I can state it plainly. So I'm very grateful for this platform that we as a church can mobilize ourselves to be watchmen and see what new thing is coming that we can fight and decree and declare that the Lord's will be done over South Sudan. So those are the three key issues. And the situation, the problems being the floods, the insecurity, the poverty, the disunity that is so rampant, both at war level, mini war level, and tribal level, with various tribes fighting against each other, and governance issues, which endemic corruption and civil intolerance and repression. We as a church can control the narrative. All it takes is one man. And scripture talks of God looking for just one man. We are a community of believers who can put our faith together to achieve God's will for South Sudan. So in finality, the peace process is being mediated by the international community. United Nations mission in South Sudan's mandate is expiring next year. Meantime, there has been peace and reconciliation meetings and an attempt to structure themselves with a new constitution, members of parliament, and have the donor community pull out gradually. Some have pulled out, some have had reductions in funding, but there's a huge need for that transition to be managed extremely well, even with the looming elections in 2023. So let us continue to uphold South Sudan in those three areas: governance, unity, and the natural, whether it's natural disaster or problems that are consequence of the other two not happening. So if I can go on there.
Yes, please go on.
Issue with Sudan that is, and I'll just, okay. The issue with Sudan that has very recently happened, where for the past months when the head of state was unseated and called to every of his rogue decisions were called to question in humanitarian interference with lives and livelihoods, there was a state of relief that there were, that the Arab Spring or the democracy, that democracy is being established in South Sudan, in Sudan. And that was quickly taken away when the military all of a sudden started to take back power, ending up in a situation where it is not a transitional government anymore. So what has happened with the reinstatement of the prime minister who was appointed, everyone is still up in arms against that, not happy about that, because they see that it is still another form or manifestation of the previous rule and regime, which was oppressive and affected a lot of lives adversely, right down to torture and the like. Right, and then with that new reinstatement of prime minister, that prime minister, there is hope that he will be a mediator, but it is the wider population of the country still feel that it is a return to the previous regime, which is something they had heaved a sigh of relief to expect that they're moving into a democratic state. It's affecting South Sudan because of economic matters, being that the port that is used for the key commodity of export is the Sudan, and therefore by extension it's affecting the economy of South Sudan. Still a lot of repression carrying on there, restricted internet access, a lot of repression of civil rights movements, etc. So I may not have mentioned it or stated it, per individual challenges, but I believe I've shared the general gist of these two nations. So I believe that we should also focus on asking of the Lord concerning the nations. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verse 4, that before we call, and while we are still speaking, God hears and God answers. This is because every nation has a purpose, every nation has a destiny, and it is up to us to right the wrong so that the kingdom of God is established in these two states. The only way we can do it is by being watchmen over any mischief that the enemy is throwing into these territories, causing the progress to be stolen away, causing a back and forth when there's a relief of evil being unseated and then being reestablished. There needs to be a consistent prayer watch concerning these nations so that peace is permanent in South Sudan, so that the situation in the Sudan does not deteriorate any further. And we can ask this of God, that the destiny of the nations of South Sudan and Sudan be established and sealed. We can refuse what the enemy is sowing in these nations. We can establish what is the will of God. And this is what I'd like to share today.
Thank you very much, Eric. I would invite us, brothers and sisters, to go ahead and pray for a minute or two, and then we'll close out in our prayer time. Thank you. Please unmute and let us cry to the God of heaven. Hallelujah. Worship. In Jesus' name. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We thank God. Amen. Just wanted to pass the program back to Bishop Nguiza to close out our time together.
Thank you so much to everybody for coming on the prayer time together. I'm sorry, but I'm not quite sorry that we took, you know, longer than we had intended. Time spent in prayer is time well invested. So thank you for your patience. Just to remind you two things as we close, just to remind you that we post a couple of, you know, prayer letters during the month. So look out for those, you know, on our website. And also to invite you to our last prayer meeting of the year, which is going to be December 16th, and it's going to be on the diaspora. You'd like to pray for those of us who are living, you know, in diaspora. So please do make that appointment on your diary for December 16th. What remains for me to say now is just thank everybody for coming, and over you. Numbers chapter 6 and verse 24 says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
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 Common vision. God bless Africa.